Our guest joining us, Stephanie Jones, who is a virtuoso guitarist, originally from Australia, and she now lives in Germany, and she's going to be joining us on this live stream. I have a lot of questions for her. I think it's going to be a really interesting conversation. So please enjoy this stream. I will be recording it for the purposes of the CGC podcast. So we will be doing just a live stream and then having some questions at the end. It has been quite a busy week, and another busy week coming up here at Classical Guitar Corner with exams going out in the early April. And then also we have a beginner's workshops next week on Monday and Wednesday for Academy members. And also on Sunday, we have an open mic hosted by Nicoletta Todesco. That's for Academy members. All are welcome to join, and it's very relaxed, comfortable way to just play through some repertoire, get an international round of applause. We unmute everybody, have that international round of applause. And it's just a nice way to be together, see one another, and play some music. So I see some people coming in. That's great. Please let me know if you can hear me, if you can see me. We will be calling our special guest very soon to welcome our interview guest, Stephanie, onto the podcast. So maybe if you're just coming in, as I said, I'm going to be recording this for the Classical Guitar Corner podcast. And so at that point, you'll see me don the headphones, and we're going to have this conversation that goes pretty much straight from when we start our conversation all the way through to the end of the conversation. But then, of course, the people who are here on the live stream are very welcome to ask some questions to Stephanie. I'm sure that you do have a lot of questions. It's a really pretty phenomenal trajectory that Stephanie's taken throughout her career, and she's got some fantastic recordings out there with equally fantastic video footage that was done by Jakob, who's part of her quartet. I don't want to say too much. I'm just trying to fill a little bit of time. I always have to wait as people come in, just make sure everyone's in here hearing correctly, seeing. We had the last interview, we had Jeff Peterson, who is an ukulele player out in Hawaii, and we went through some really interesting arrangements that he's done from classical guitar music through to ukulele. And I suppose on some level there's you can think of it almost as the top four strings of a guitar, so we can translate a lot of that. Prior to that, we had Ben Verdery and Gohar Vardanyan on these live streams as an interview, and I think I might try and see if we can format those for the podcast as well, because I know not everyone chimes in here to listen to the live stream. But it's great to see everyone. I see Jenna. Hi, Jenna. Saw a really great performance of yours on Facebook recently, sounding great. Les. Hi, Les. Great to see you again. I actually just submitted your exam review this afternoon, so great to see your name again after having seen your playing this afternoon. Roger, hello Roger, great to see you. Hope you're doing well up there in New Hampshire. Martin is there from saying hey hey from Sweden, and of course he actually had the pleasure of seeing Stephanie perform in Sweden. I think it's the Uppsala Guitar Festival, if I'm not mistaken. And so Martin's here, probably quite late, I suppose. I know it's about 10 p.m. for Stephanie, so it'll be a bit late for those people in Europe. But thank you, everyone, for saying hello. Feel free to share this link around for this live stream on your Facebook and invite other people to come and listen, because I think it's going to be a really great conversation. Trevor, tuning in from New Zealand. Hello, hope you're safe down there, Trevor. Vince, Bernd, great to see everyone coming in. So, and I know Mr. Dave Belcher is in there in the comments as well. So, it's great to have everyone tune in. I think it's just about time to call Stephanie. So, I will don the headphones. So we get good sound for our recording, and let's call Oh, there's Jeff. Jeffrey Wilt. Hi, Jeffrey. We're about to have a live meeting for the New York Classical Guitar Society tonight on Zoom, so that will be an experience. And greetings from Italy. Fantastic. All right, okay, it's time to call Stephanie. Let's have a go. Bring up the old Skype. Stephanie is unavailable, apparently. Let's try that one more time. Oh, sounds good. Hello. All right, let me just bring you up. There you are. Welcome to this live stream here in Classical Guitar Corner. There's a lot of people tuned in from all over the world, from New Zealand, from Italy, from all over the US.
Wow.
All excited
awesome.
To.
Awesome. Well, it's great to be here.
Well, yeah.
In my room. Great to be online here.
You said this is the first live streaming type thing you've done before. At all. It's the first time. It's a different beast. I was just saying on the last stream that it sort of invokes similar kind of feelings as a live performance sometimes.
Definitely.
It's a bit of an odd one. So
I'm almost more nervous.
Right. I don't know. It's different.
Like, it's like online, you can't see your audience and like connect with them in the same way, you know?
Absolutely, yeah. Well, do you remember Martin Bergström from the Uppsala Guitar Festival? He's there saying hello. Anyway, so what we're going to do is we're going to dive into the podcast. Please, just before we dive in, can everyone hear Stephanie? I think we probably would have heard already if that's been a problem, but let me know if you can hear Stephanie all right. And then we'll dive in. So what time?
I could probably follow the live stream on my computer and then I can see some questions as well. Would that be?
Sure, yeah. Kerry says it's welcome Stephanie, it's so cool to have you here. And oh, thank you Michael, everyone's saying it's all okay.
Great.
Well, so I wanted to ask first and foremost, how are you doing in these weird and strange times?
Yeah, I mean, I think for everybody it's definitely a big adjustment to coping with. I mean, I know a lot of people have been highly affected with the canceling of concerts and whatnot, and I mean, I lost my whole US tour in April. I'm supposed to be in San Fran now, I think. so that's a really big shame. But I mean, I hope everything can be rescheduled in the future, of course. And it's being at home, and it was sort of a little bit odd because, I mean, I was so busy doing all the CD work and some videos for the CD work and everything, and I was prepping my program, doing some concerts in Europe and stuff, and I was like, got this program ready for the US, and then suddenly it was like nothing. And then I sort of just went and I was like, just, you know, you're just at home, you're like, well, what do I do now? sort of thing. So it's been this sort of development of like seeing what we can do, more opportunities like this online, and keeping busy. And I mean, I already learned like a bunch of new program for my CD, and then now I'm thinking, oh, I guess I can learn more program. So I was like learning more pieces and trying to keep active how you can and stuff, because I think the first few days was a, you know, it's hard at first when I think I found it a bit tough just to cope with the uncertain times in a way, you know.
Absolutely.
Making sure everyone's safe. And
yeah, and I think it's it's a slightly odd feeling when I didn't have any plans to go back to Australia in the short term, but it's different when you know you can't really easily get back. It's sort of mentally a little. It's not a nice feeling, but. But yes, this too shall pass. So we look forward to seeing you in the US on your next tour when it does get rescheduled.
Yeah.
So I'd love to know a bit about your story. So you grew up in Perth, is that correct?
Yep.
And we probably better start. I mean, the question that we often get asked online is, what guitar is that you're playing? And I've never really talked to anyone else that plays a Sheridan. So can you tell us a little bit
your
about
opportunity?
Yeah. So can you tell us a little bit about your instrument? And sort of that can be our starting point for your travels to where you are now.
Yes, I got my Paul Sheridan guitar in my first year when I started studying in Canberra at the Australian National University. And Paul Sheridan is a Perth luthier. And I was exploring like different types of guitars I can play, trying a lot of different Australian guitars, a small guitar, all these really big names. And I met Paul, came over and showed us a few of his instruments to the whole class, and I was really impressed. And then I was back in Perth for holidays or whatnot, and he had this one guitar. This guitar that I have now was already built, so I didn't order it or anything. And he had this one guitar that was ready, and I gave it a go. And as soon as I started playing it just felt so right for my hands. I don't know, like, I've got really small hands, and so it's not only that, it's just sort of the make of it is just this beautiful ease in sound creation, I feel like. And it's like this instrument that is both resonant and loud, like most Australian guitars seem to have that characteristic, but it doesn't, it still allows you to have a lot of different tone colors and variety in sound and a lot of depth to it as well. And I just thought, well, like, I've got to take this home. I think it was like, yeah, no, I think it was completely ready. And I was like, I have to take this back. And so that was just the end of that. It happened so quickly. I've never looked back. I mean, I'm just terrified to take it anywhere because I don't want anything to happen to it. You know, it's like, it's really my baby. It's really like just like my arm or my leg or something. If anything happened to it, I'd probably be absolutely just devastated.
Yes, everyone listening can touch wood right now. I think a lot of people share your feelings about their instruments. So that's kind of funny that you found a luthier from your own hometown, but you had to go all the way to Canberra first, which for those who don't know is on the other side of the country.
It's like 5 hours away by
Yeah.
flying, which is
Well, that's great.
quite
So
far,
tell,
actually.
did you study with Jonathan Paget in Perth? Is that who you're working with, or was it somebody else?
No, I was with Alan Banks in
Oh,
my
okay.
high school years. And he was great because like we'd always have like a lesson to do all like classical pieces and stuff, and at the very end of the lesson he's like, well, we've got to do some Jimi Hendrix. We've got to do some like jazz licks, or we've got to do some like gypsy jazz or something. So he always gave like 20 minutes at the end just to like do a bunch of different styles. So he's very much like a obviously a classical guitarist, but also has that sort of the versatility. And he recommended me to go to Canberra because there's the amazing Tim Kaine there, and also Min Liu Hong. And I went over there for my undergraduate when I was 17.
What are some of the key things you remember having worked with Tim and Min?
I think the first biggest overhaul, I think, was my right hand technique. So I had a good right hand technique, and I mean, it was quite fast, but it was a little bit jumpy. So one key aspect that I remember developing in my first year is making that really smooth movements with that. And also, they have a really amazing way of bringing a lot of attention to musicality in interpretation and making a clear message with a piece and following the phrases and the lines and how to follow across phrases and whatnot. That's sort of a big takeaway that I can get from I got from Tim and Min. They did a really, really amazing job. And it's just like they were mentors as well. So we had this like good community where we pushed ourselves really well there. And I developed a lot in my Canberra years, definitely.
Yeah, Tim is a fantastic leader of the community there in Canberra, and a lot of fantastic guitarists have passed through that location. It's sort of one of those kind of like Jose Tomas in the north of Spain. You know, there's sort of sometimes little locations that a lot of fantastic players go through. So then, what took you to Weimar in Germany?
So, I really wanted to come to Europe, and I was exploring many different teachers, so many good teachers everywhere. And I heard of Weimer and Thomas Müller Pering through Tim Kaine. And also Ricardo Guillén also visited us in Canberra and did a concert. And I was just like, whoa, this seems like the place to be. And I knew a couple of people who had gone to Germany and had a really good experience there. Harold Gretton is an example of that. Campbell Diamond also went there. Jesse Flowers also went there before me. And then I sort of thought, it seems like a really good place to continue my development. And it's been really great in Europe. It's funny because, as Australian, especially coming from Perth, it's like, as we were saying before, Canberra is 5 hours by flying. It's like there's only, unfortunately, it is an isolated country, and it's got so much going for it. But in Europe, and in the US, it's just like you have a festival every like few days, like every weekend or something, and like you could just a concert, just and you just hop on a train a few hours, and then you're there. It's everything is unbelievably close. I think the distance between Moscow and Lisbon is the same as Perth to Sydney or something. Like it's just a different scale. And so I think coming to Weimar and learning with Thomas, he's been absolutely amazing. And well, another fantastic mentor that helped me settle really well in Germany. I mean, it's a huge step to go. I just seem to keep moving around a bit. At 17, you go across Australia, and then a few years later, you hop across by yourself. You like don't know anybody going across there. It's quite daunting at first, and then you just meet so many wonderful people, and it just sort of all went on from there.
What are some of the things that you feel you took away from your time in Weimar? What how did that change your playing?
Well, it's just like went up another level of exploring different pieces, developing musically more maturely, and getting more of that confidence. And another big part of that was that I met some amazing musicians in the Weimar Guitar Quartet. So I met Jakob Schmidt there. He does all my videos and recordings, and also Hannah Link and Carmen Stendler. There's absolutely like awesome musicians to play with them. And so like that's one of the big takeaways as well, is that ensemble work was just, it's so rewarding. I think it's like it's hard it's a, you've got to do ensemble work as a musician. I think it's really something that just elevates everything.
Yeah, and it's such a
Definitely.
wonderful gift when you can meet colleagues like that, that you can form a professional quartet. And they do, your quartet does sound fantastic. And as I said before, when I was chatting to you, Jakob's skills on the video and audio are absolutely phenomenal. So he's done a lot of all the recordings that we would have seen on YouTube, and does he also do the audio recording for your new album?
Yes, he did. He did
Wow.
the audio for that as well. We had the recording equipment you needed, because it's like you need the top mics and whatnot, and the room and everything. And he's yeah, I don't know how he does everything so well. It's amazing. I just like. Just learns it all himself. It's incredible.
Yeah, we'll have to invite him on for a conversation. I think there'd be a lot he could offer to share as well. That's it. So, one of the, we do want to also talk about your recent project with the recording, but one big question, sort of umbrella, I'd like to talk about is social media and your presence on YouTube and your popularity within this sort of social media world around the world. I've got so many curiosities about it. I guess, first of all, when did you find that that trajectory started to take off? When did you notice that the internet started recognizing you in perhaps a different way?
I think that started around about when my videos started looking more professional with Jakob. So I always had like a really nice little following, and I always had a lot of really good responses. And I think what was really beneficial was that I already had a lot of content from concerts and videos on my bed, like on the couch and in my living room and whatnot. And then what I what I did was we had a few professional videos, and also we went to a big channel. Like, it's always good to collaborate. So I went with and did a few videos with Sick House Guitars, and they have a huge following. And I think a lot of people from there came across, and I already had a lot of content that they could then follow on to and listen to. And then I think it was pretty soon after we started posting quite regular videos. It was the Walton Bagatelles and Recuerdos and a few other Romanza as well. There was a bunch of videos that we did in the first 6 months of the year that we did very regularly, and really happy with the quality and stuff, you know.
Yeah,
so I think that's when it started going. It's you got to have regular content, and you got to have, you know, you got to be happy with the quality as well. And yeah.
Do you have any sense? Do you feel in control of how things, what kind of trajectory they have, of their popularity, of how they're received? I had this kind of conversation with, I'm forgetting his name right now, but the gentleman that's the president of GSI down in Santa Monica in California. And they were talking about a couple of videos that just went absolutely, well, viral, you know, but in terms of in the guitar bubble, compared to other ones that did not. Do you have any sense or of why that might happen from one to another?
It's hard to say. I mean, sometimes you got to say that it's up to the YouTube algorithm gods as well,
right?
Part of it. But also, I mean, I definitely believe that something about the quality of the playing plays a huge part in it. I think people notice that. And also, I mean, I don't know about the GSI. I think sometimes maybe, I mean, I got some comments that people, they were intrigued by the thumbnail because I had interesting hair or something, you know, like something that eye-catching, like, oh, you know, no one's really like looks quite like that or something, and then they click on it and they're like, oh, she plays guitar really well or something, you know. There's those sorts of aspects. There's definitely things you can make it more likely, avoid things that are more unlikely, you know, like not putting too much title time at the start of the video. You go straight into the video, into the sounds. Like, people click on your video to listen to it. They don't want to see 10-20 seconds of a title playing or something. Like, there's definitely ways to make it more likely, but it's not completely in control. So I can post content that sometimes will do really well, and other things that you hear this a lot from, actually, from YouTubers that talk about this. And you know, they say some of the videos that I post, like the worst ones that I post, they do really, really well. And you're like, well, I didn't expect that. And then other ones that do well. So you don't have complete control, but there's definitely influences that you can do.
And what has this resulted in? What does it feel and look like on your end to have videos that do have a really good reach on the online?
Well, it translates really well into life, you know. It's social media is such a great vehicle. I mean before all this happened, and nobody knew who I was, you know, I was just like doing my thing and trying to get better and all that. But then, you know, I started getting a lot more concert invites, more collaboration, people wanted to talk to me, people sending messages. I'm like, oh wow, people are really enjoying what I'm doing. This is really cool. And you know, and they come to my concerts. I get really just that you guys are really lovely. Oh my goodness, like my fans are amazing. I meet them at the concerts. Like, oh, I saw you on Instagram, or I saw you on YouTube, or I know you from the interwebs, sort of thing. And it's like, wow, like you get to meet the people that you actually sharing what you have online. I mean, you like, I barely make any money from my online stuff, but it's a great vehicle and to meet people and to get myself out there and get concerts and whatnot. So it's translated really well into these sorts of things.
And do you think from a promoter point of view that they could expect more people to attend a concert if someone had a larger social media following?
Definitely. I mean, I know when I ever want to go to a concert or something, I want to see what they like, a snippet of what they sound like online, you know. I always YouTube Google them first and see what they sound like. And I mean, that's what people do these days. And I'm very, very fortunate that I get such a, like, I think it's, I get a good turnout to a lot of the concerts that I do. So it definitely translates really well into that.
Yeah, the reason I asked that specifically is because I've talked with a number of people who either run societies or put on concerts, and I was so keen to ask you that question because a lot of people who put on the concerts don't think that it translates.
Really?
And I haven't talked to too many people. I mean, I'm good friends with Gohar Vardanyan, and she has, I think, a good YouTube presence and a social media presence, and she's active with communicating with people. There's also
Yeah.
another guitarist here in New York City. Hannah Goldberg, I believe her name is. She's got a strong Instagram presence. But I haven't ha been able to sort of ask that kind of question. And have you been able to quantify it at all? Is it just your sort of general sense from people coming up to you and saying, I've seen you online? Or is there something, is there, yeah,
I
is
haven't
it?
run the numbers, but like I it's definitely it's there's definitely some sort of correlation there. I mean, I've got to say that I think it's more likely from YouTube to get people from there. I'm not sure how many translates from Instagram, for example. But I get people coming up to me and tell me that they've traveled a couple of hours to come see my concert from the other side of Germany or something, and it's like, well, like, wow, okay, thank you. It's yeah, I mean, I can definitely, the amount of people that I talk to afterwards that say that they've seen me online or they've heard of me, or it's you don't even have to be a fan that comes to the concert. It's just like also that there is something online where someone, the presenter, can share it on their Facebook or to their people, their base, and then the people hear it, they like it, and then results come. And if they have nothing to share, then people are probably less likely to come. I mean, it's just a, I think it's pretty clear that that would be, and that's my experience in, anyway. So,
Yeah,
yeah.
I do remember years ago. There's a band on. It's actually the guy who started Patreon. His name is Jack Conti, and he's with his wife. He has a group called Pomplamoose. I don't know if you've ever come across them. This is a
No.
kind of an indie rock band. They're extremely creative and really great music. So Pomplamoose, French for pineapple. If I'm, I think that's right. But yeah,
Pomplamoose.
exactly, Pomplamoose. And I went to a concert of theirs in Brooklyn years and years ago, and it was packed to the rafters. I mean, and they only had a presence online. So that for me, that was a very clear correlation. But it's been interesting talking to different parties, and thank you for your input, because now I can go back to those conversations with
Oh.
some, a bit more context.
Okay.
So I'd like to talk about your recent recording project, and maybe we can play a few excerpts. So it's called Open Sky. Can you tell us a bit about that title?
So Open Sky is the translation of the first track, Cielo Abierto, which is by Kiki Sinisi, which is an Argentinian composer who lives in Germany. And I was shown this piece by a really amazing teacher, Stefan Schmidt, about a year ago, and absolutely fell in love with just the energy and the vibrance of this work. It's just so catchy and captivating. And it's sort of a piece that sparks hope and development. And I just thought that that was very fitting for these times, and also just the encompassing of these many different countries of South America and the music and these collaborations that I did with it. I sort of thought it all really fit really well together. Yeah,
Well,
so it's a really, sorry.
sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off. It's a really what?
It's just a really exciting project to do because I got to collaborate with Sergio Assad on a new composition, and also with the artist of the cover art that maybe you've seen by Ledania, who's a Colombian street artist. So yeah, that's what I was
Yeah,
saying.
there is a kind of vibrancy that does pervade almost all of your work. So it's beautiful. I really enjoy, I do enjoy the artwork of it. I've just been looking at the comments, and I've been corrected by the interwebs. So it's grapefruit. Pamplemousse means grapefruit. We've had our French.
Oh, okay, yeah. I was thinking. I think it's ananas. Ananas. Ananas is everywhere besides in English. I remember.
Right. Yes. Thank you. Thank you. The interwebs. All right. So I'm going to just now line up a little bit. So this is not the same recording from your album. This is Cielo Abierto, but it was filmed a couple of years ago, I think. Is that correct?
Last year.
Okay. This is not the same. It's the same piece from the album, but not the same audio. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Right. Okay. So I'll play a little bit of this. Sorry, I have to do a little bit of shenanigans, muting and screen sharing and whatnot. I know the last thing anyone wants to hear is my voice right now, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to fast forward towards the end because there's some really great percussion in this piece. I'm going to highlight that, so here we go. Well, there's a little bit of a taste of it there. Sorry, I think I was muted there. I have to say that all again. So wonderful playing there, wonderful footage. And it made me think about your connection with Alan Banks back in Perth that you started with, and he would end the lesson by saying, okay, we're done with the classical now, let's do some Jimi Hendrix. And do you think that it's fun to think about the threads that go through our life and make an impact later on. Do you think that that had an impact with your openness to experimenting into different types of music?
Yeah, definitely. And also I spent a lot of time, especially in my teenage years, I played the saxophone a lot. And it was like in Canberra, I studied saxophone as a minor in the jazz department. So it's that sort of these different genres and styles have been a big part of my musical development, playing all these different instruments and whatnot. And the guitar is such a versatile instrument. It's like I had jazz guitar lessons in Canberra as well, actually. It's funny, we had two buildings. We had the jazz building and the classical building, and it's like I went over to the other side, like to the dark side, and did a lot of that and played in their bands and stuff and everything. And I mean, it is absolutely invaluable to experience different genres and have that versatility, because I mean, yeah, the guitar is such a versatile instrument that like it's almost sad if you don't look into these. It's like almost unavoidable, actually, just to play all these different pieces. I mean, we've got like our repertoire is so vast, and not in the sense of how numerous it is, but in the sense of how many different styles and different directions it can go in. And I think it makes you a better musician to be able to understand and feel these different aspects of music. And yeah, I mean, the saxophone especially it's very clearly a melodic instrument, and I think that really helped me with phrasing melodies and bringing them out more as well. It's just sort of these physical aspects as well that really helped. So definitely.
There's also a really great groove that you sit in this piece, and Felicidade, and in general, I think your rhythm is. It's, I mean, sometimes guitarists, we all know, we just don't talk about it. Our rhythm is a slightly lacking, and I imagine, especially jazz work, and maybe was saxophone was in the context of jazz? Was it a big band? Yeah. So I mean,
Big bands, smaller bands, that sort of thing.
so that's going to feed into your rhythmic skills, and being another famous Perth-based guitarist, Craig Ogden. Is a phenomenal rhythmist, and he started on percussion.
Oh, did he? I
Yeah,
didn't know that. Oh,
he was a
awesome. Well, there you
percussionist.
go.
Yeah, so I really think those other musical skills translate very positively through to classical guitar.
Yeah. I mean, I've had people have comments when I was younger. I was like, oh, it's a shame that you play so many different instruments, because imagine if you focused all that time onto your guitar and how good you would be. I'm thinking, like, no, that's not how it works. I mean, doing these other things is what's helping me make my guitar better. So I encourage, like, never shy away from exploring different experiences in music and musicality, definitely.
Absolutely. It feeds into that idea that we are the musical instrument, the primary musical instrument, and the other ones are sort of somewhat secondary there.
Yeah, I like that.
Yeah. Well, let's listen to another track after I can get my juggling done with all the sounds. This is Ottonio Portenio. So this is a direct track from the album. Can you tell me what it was like to learn these pieces? Because I've definitely played through them. They're fantastic arrangements, but they're pretty darn tricky.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, you're right. They are pretty fiddly. Especially Primavera is super fiddly. Oh my goodness. All that counterpoint going on there. Sergio did an amazing job arranging them, but he didn't make it easy for us, that's for sure. I think that the most important thing is with these pieces, I mean, you try to make it as I was going to say as clean as possible, but you don't need it to be clean, because it's got to have that grungy feel, but it's also got to have that spunk. Like you're talking about the rhythm before, is that you're making sure that you're really focusing on the accents, especially you can hear in the autumnal with the melody, you can hear the where the accents are, and really bringing out that character and flavor. I think that's like half of the difficulty, is bringing that stylistic development into the piece, and cohesiveness, I should
Yeah.
say.
All right, well, let's have a listen. We're going to have a listen to Ottonio Portenio. And now I'm really paranoid about translating words, but autumn, I believe, is that's the season,
Yes. What do you
right?
think? I get confused. I have like dyslexia with like translation sometimes.
Well, over here, they call it the fall, so it's doubly tricky.
Yes.
All right, let's give this a go. Great. Just checking all my mutes. So tell us a little bit about how you approach Piazzolla, that sort of tango world. Did you come at it from, have you ever done any tango dancing? Have you ever played in any of the bands? Like, do you have any experience with tango in that context?
I played with some tango dancers last year and did some dancing, and That was so much fun, but I felt really embarrassed by that. But I, besides playing a bit of like tango music in terms of the big band and stuff, you know, a lot of these types of South American genres, I haven't had that much experience. I listen to a lot of Piazzolla. I mean, you get a lot from he's a lot got a lot of original recordings, which I think helped a lot. I wish I did more tango dance lessons. Like the extent of my dance experience is doing Zumba to keep active, and it's like that's not quite the same thing. Yeah, I mean, it's just something you fall in love with so quickly. It's such a passionate genre of music. It's so absolutely captivating, and that really sparked something in me, and just really easily persuaded me to just do a lot of this type of music. And then when I posted in Viano, and that video in Viano went like crazy, like it was like a few million views or something now, something insane. I'm like, oh my goodness, like people love this, and I need to do more of this. And this is so much fun. So it all worked out really well.
Well, I
It came
think
together really well.
that all of the arrangements are great for the whole season, but Inverno is particularly inspired. I think it just
Yeah,
sounds
there's an
so
extra
good.
depth to that. Yeah, there's an extra depth to that piece.
Well, Dave Belcher, who's in the chat, could I ask you, Dave, to post the link for Stephanie's website where people can find that recording, and then I'll put it up on, I can actually superimpose it on the video here. What can you just tell us, the people listening on the podcast in the future, how to find the recording?
Yeah, so you can find the download of it on my website, stephaniejonesguitar.com, and you just go into the store section and they have the digital files there. There's so many restrictions on postage at the moment that I'm unable to send anything off, basically. I mean, I have a whole box here of all these lovely supporters on my Kickstarter that live mainly in the US and Australia and New Zealand, that we can't send anything there at the moment, which is crazy. So I'm only doing download at the moment, until that all clears up a bit. And yeah, it's all on there.
Great.
Please check
Well, yeah, no,
it out.
I'm sure a lot of people have been really giving a lot of kudos in the comments here after even just these small excerpts. I'm sure you've got some new fans you can add.
Thank you.
Well, we'll have some questions from the people on the live stream in a little bit, but just to wrap up the podcast, can you tell us what about some of your projects? Travel restrictions aside, but some of the projects you have lined up for the future.
Okay, so I am playing with have you heard of International Guitar Night?
I
And they
have,
get a,
yeah.
yeah?
Well,
So
Ben,
I'm in
if,
the,
yeah, sorry, go ahead.
no, I'm going to be a part of that for this next season. We're supposed to be doing a tour of like Europe, mainly Germany, in October. It's really cool. They get different people each sort of season, and they get like a, this year it's gypsy jazz, a jazz guitarist, fingerstyle, and myself. And they get together, and we play a bunch of pieces together, we do a few solo pieces, and it's just a really enriching concert experience. That and then we're supposed to be going, I keep saying supposed to and everything, it's a bit of a shame, but we're supposed to be going to Canada and the US for a big tour next January, February, March. So I hopefully will be able to get to the US through that at least. So they're the biggest projects that are coming up in the near future. The biggest project that I was doing was that CD, and that's all done now. And I'm studying a concert examen as well, so I need to do more with that as well,
I'm
and
sorry,
just
what is
learning
that?
a concert examen. It's like the degree after master's, but in Germany. So it's a performance degree. They don't have things like PhDs and whatnot in Germany, but they have something called a concert examen. So I'm studying that still with Thomas Miller-Pering in Weimar, and I really just want to keep making more content online and sharing it with you guys and keep going with that. I don't think I'm forgetting anything. I don't think
Well, that sounds fantastic. The reason I'd heard of International Guitar Night is because Ben Vertery went on it a few years back, and he raved about it, saying because they amplify like crazy. So you get this sort of
Yeah.
really fun experience of having your guitar sound like one of those giant rock
Sick.
bands. So
Awesome.
I'm looking forward to hearing how that experience is. I'm sure it'll be
Yeah.
fantastic. So it's great. Well, thank you very much, Stephanie. Stay with us because we're going to ask some questions. But it was really wonderful to hear a bit of your story, to hear some of your playing. And thank you for all of everything you shared.
Thank you for having me. It's been lovely to chat with
Yeah. All right. And now, cut, everyone. That's the end of the podcast.
See you
And that's
later.
the end of. So that was great. Do you still feel, how's, do you feel, have you settled into the live stream
Yeah.
energy?
I think I'm feeling more comfortable now. I think I was like feeling a little shaky before. I think my
Right.
voice was a little shaky. I was like, oh my goodness, I hope it's not coming through too much. But yeah, I'm feeling more comfortable now.
Great. Well,
Yes.
let me know if you can. I know it's getting late over there, but I will just bring up a couple of questions. A lot of people sort of just saying hello and we miss you and when's your next concert here and love your playing. So Embra Craig asked if there's anything in the works with the Weimar Quartet.
Yeah, we've just got a new composition written for us that we're really excited to do, and we're organizing a whole new program to do, and we're hoping to get that all out next year. So it's been a bit of a pause, yeah, with the virus and everything, and so we're just in the process of building up new repertoire, but there'll be more coming soon.
Great.
We actually have a video that we can post at some point that we need to get ready first. So
Very
something
cool.
from
Oh,
the
and also
alphas.
question from, oh, that was question number two by this. But the first question was, did you find working on the new piece from Sergio Assad to be a different process at all from working on existing pieces?
Yeah, that's a good question. It definitely was. It's like the first piece that I've done that is absolutely brand new. And it's a really interesting experience. Like, you don't have any basis to go listen to, maybe see how this person plays it or this person plays it. It's like you're really developing that sort of yourself and with the composer Sergio. So we had like a Skype session ourselves to make sure I'm fulfilling his vision as well as bringing what I can into it. And yeah, it's definitely a very organic approach. I want to do more of it. It's definitely something that it's really fulfilling to like bring something new to the table, and it's just such a captivating piece. It's the bottom string is tuned down a semitone to E flat, so it's got these like really interesting harmonies, and very picturesque. Yeah, so he did an amazing job with that piece. I'm really happy to have that he gave that to me.
Wow, that's great. Matthew Goss says, sounds like the future of classical guitar is in very good hands with guitarists like Stephanie. True.
Thank you.
So we have, here's a very small question. Well, you can answer in 5 seconds. What is your practice routine? Well, I think, is there anything, let me try and refine that down to, is there anything that you find, what's your thing that maybe you do very often or you find very useful in your practice sessions? Is there anything that you repeat on a regular basis?
I have to think about this. So, what do I do? Like, I do this all day, every day. I'm like, wait, what do we do every day? It's like, well, I've got to make sure at the start to, don't go straight into it. Start slow and warm those hands up. I was doing a learning a few months ago when I was like super busy with the CD and whatnot. I have a lot of problems with my left hand. I got a bit of pain in that because it's too much pressure of the thumb onto the fingerboard, and I need to remember to relax that. And it's being very something that most important about practicing a practice schedule is to warm up well. And that's even just stretching beforehand and whatnot, and also to be very mindful of what you're physically doing. And so, like, paying really good attention to how your hands are feeling, how your arm is feeling, and not putting too much pressure. And really, yeah, it's really mindfulness in the session. And I do a lot of small practice sessions throughout the day rather than really big blocks. I know some people do like hour blocks and stuff. That's like huge to me. I would do max 20 or something because I'm giving my hand that rest. It's like we're athletes and we gotta take care of our bodies and whatnot. So
Yeah,
that's
absolutely.
like one tiny bit I can say
Yeah,
about
for sure.
the
No, I'm sure
practice.
James appreciates that. Here is a very small question. Martin, who I mentioned, saw you at the Uppsala Festival, he says, I still carry the feel. So he's asking what you open up the concert with. He says he still carries the feeling but can't remember the piece. Do you remember what you played as the opening piece in that concert?
I played a few in Uppsala. Maybe the last one. Oh, jeez. I remember that the last one in Uppsala, last October, it was like I added a lot of new pieces. I'm not sure what order I did there. Was it the Black Cockatoo? Could be the Australian piece by Richard Charlton. It's always good to start with a piece you feel really comfortable with. To sort of warm up on stage.
Well, let's say it
I can
was.
look it up
Sure. Oh, okay. Yeah.
at
Well.
some point and let you know. I had a huge program of Piazzolla, Cielo Abierto, maybe that was the first one actually. That could have been it because that was, oh, maybe that was the end piece because that's really fiery. I don't know. It's we're really thinking about the storyline of the concert and what's more comfortable
Well,
to start with.
speaking of the Black Cockatoo, so this is a piece by Richard Charlton, who's a Sydney-based composer, and black cockatoos are one of the birds, those types of birds that mate for life. They have pairs for life. And the name of it is A Black Cockatoo Flies Alone. Is that correct? Is that the full title? And so it's kind of a melancholy theme. And that draws us into the question from Erica, who, no, excuse me, Les asked, how do European audiences react to Aussie classical guitar music that you play?
I mean, I think every time I play this piece, it's like everyone's favorite piece in the program.
Oh,
They always
great.
go like, "Oh, that Australian piece was so lovely." I was like, "All right, I got to keep this one in." it's also my mum's favorite piece, so that's why I play it so often, because I like to keep it up, so I can play it to her whenever I can. And yeah, I think people really respond really well. And I mean, Australian music, there's so much amazing Australian music. It's very it's like you can really imagine the landscapes. It's very picturesque. It's sort of very evocative, that type of music. I feel like the composers in Australia are really good at getting that down pack, and people really connect with that, I think. Actually, Richard has written me a piece that I'm getting up so that I record and hopefully post it up in the next month or two.
Oh, great.
Called Beneath River of Stars. So it's like the night sky in Australia is like, as you would know, is just in like so incredible when you just drive out a little bit from town and it's like so many stars. It's just absolutely beautiful. So I hope people like that as much as the cockatoo.
And we might end with one last question because we need to let you go and relax. But let me see. Oh, here's it. Well, this again, it's a big topic, but how do you deal with nerves when performing?
Yeah, I mean, I'm one of those it's hard. I mean, different things work for different people. It's definitely a big part of calming your nerve is doing a lot of performance practice. So a lot of like family has to listen to me play all the time because I'm like, okay, you gotta listen to this piece, you gotta listen to this piece, you know, and it's like I've heard this piece how many times now, and sort of gotta make sure that you have that practice, that experience of being nervous. That's really important. And also when you're just before on stage, I have lots of little hand warmers to keep my hands really warm. That calms me down. And also for me, a lot of people it doesn't work for, but for me, I have to keep my fingers on the guitar. I know there's a lot of people that leave their guitar on stage and then they can just relax that way and then they just go on and play. And I'm like, oh my goodness, you're insane. Like, I have to make sure that I can still play guitar. Like, I've said this thing in my head, like, I haven't like played for like a minute or something. And I'm like, okay, I just need to check that I can like, you know, still play this piece. It makes no sense, but of course I can, but that's how I feel most comfortable when I'm with my guitar right up until I have to go on. And having that experience and that lot of practice with the nervousness of going and playing in front of people as well. And chocolate.
Chocolate.
This helps as well.
I'm also a chocolate. I have my little, my rationale is, even if it's just a placebo effect, it's still an effect. So I get dark chocolate, banana, and water.
Yeah.
So the idea.
Potassium, huh?
Right, exactly. Potassium for the, and potentially beta blockers, you never know. Dark chocolate is a quick energy. Banana is a slow energy. And then water is because I always forget to drink it. So it's good to be hydrated. Yeah. That's my little.
That's good. I feel like I always get like sugar lows really badly, so I need to just have like some sort of like chocolate just nearby just to keep me not so shaky. I don't know if that really means anything, but
no, absolutely.
It's just good to have snacks. Snacks are great.
Yeah.
Kind of say.
Well, thank you so much. I'm going to put your link up one more time for those who want to go and get the album. But thank you, Stephanie. It's been a real pleasure. Thank you for your music. Thank you for sharing your stories. And I'm sure we look forward to seeing more of what you do in the future.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for having me. It's been such a pleasure to be here.
And you have
to chat to you.
You have to tell Jakob he's next. We're going to pick his brain. All right.
All right.
Take it. Take care, Stephanie. Good night. Bye-bye.
See ya.
Well, thanks, everyone. I think you'll agree that it was just a wonderful chance to hear some stories behind Stephanie's path as a musician, performing, her projects. Obviously one of the real shining stars of the classical guitar scene, doing some fantastic things. And what a privilege to speak to her. So thank you, Stephanie. Thank you everyone for tuning in and listening. We are doing these live streams at the moment during this time, Tuesdays and Thursdays at 4 p.m. So the same time we started today, and we sometimes work on pieces and sometimes interview wonderful performers just like Stephanie. So, and don't worry, you will be able to see, we're going to put this on the podcast as the our actual conversation in the audio. And then of course this will be up on YouTube as a replay. We don't have any plans for taking that down anytime soon. So thank you everyone. Stay safe, be healthy, and be inspired. I always forget to say that, but we should say that. Be inspired. All right. Take care, everyone. Good night.